Welcome to the Business Lounge, and my guest today, Sandro Forte, not only a financial analyst, a financial, well, guru, I suppose, we'll come on to that in a moment or two, but also a motivational speaker and someone who commands the attention sometimes of up to 7,000 or 8,000 people in one go. I mean, that's no mean feat, is it, talking to that level of people in one room?
Oh no, it'd be fair to say that the first time I ever presented to actually 10,000 people in San Francisco in 2000, I discovered the colour of adrenaline that day.
Yeah, I bet you did. Let's go right back to the beginning, though, Sandro, because people, I suppose, when they hear the name Forte, the surname Forte, will automatically associate it with the amazingly popular hotel and leisure chain that was Trust House Forte, now the Rocco Forte collection. You're part of that family, but you decided to not go into the family business.
Yeah, I decided that I was so far down the pecking order when it came to when it came to the riches of and distributions within the family that I'd had to start my own career. So there is a slightly tenuous link because Sir Rocco and I, apart from being distantly related, I run their UK pension scheme. So we still work together, and I run a number of investments for him as well. So we still indirectly work together, but I'm a poorly paid relation.
I doubt that. But you are a financial guru, and you started very young, didn't you? 21 years old?
Yes, actually, my background, and not many people know this, and I'm not quite sure why I'm sharing this with you now, but my background was drama. I did an English and drama degree, and picked up, as a very young man at the time, a lot of acting work, and ended up being offered a job by Andrew Lloyd Webber. Decided that I didn't really see myself living in the damp, squalid bedsit in London at the age of 21 on £140 a week. So went back to my hometown of Weston-super-Mare in the West Country and picked up a job quite by chance working for a family friend who had set up his own financial services business, and saw that at the time purely as an opportunity to pay off the student overdraft. So I worked there for a couple of years, and then soon figured out that I had a bit of a propensity for selling, and realised that it was a much better way to make money, and consequently stayed in that business and then built my own from about 1996.
Do you have to be, if you're in the financial services industry, do you have to be a good salesman to be a good financier?
No, I tell you what I think you have to be. I think you have to be a good people person. All my best relationships have been built on long-term relationships that have been built on trust and confidence and a good understanding of the individual. Mm-hmm. Salesmanship is a sort of a maligned word, I think, and I see a lot of people who are very, very good, what you and I would deem salespeople, you know, could sell fridges to Eskimos and convince people to do things sometimes almost against their will, and we've read about them and we've seen them in action. The success, I guess, of my business and many of the other businesses that I coach has been born purely of a need and a desire and a wish to build really, really solid relationships with people. I think if you understand people and you communicate well with them, they like you and they trust you, you have a bedrock of a very successful business.
Well, I know you're going to be talking a lot more about financial issues and financial matters. You can see Graham Bonus's chat with Sandro in another part of this website, and the educational part of the videos on this website. But I want to deal more with how you make other people tick and, mm-hmm. and how you inspire other people, because from the financial side, you then moved on slightly to motivational speaking. Now, how did that come about?
Yes, it would be fair to say it remains a sort of a moonlighting activity for me. My financial services business, which is now really a wealth management business for all intents and purposes, is the main thrust of what I do. The motivational speaking side, and that also developed into workshops for large companies, small companies, not just in the UK, but the US, the Far East. I currently speak and work in about 58 different countries. So that takes up a fair amount of time, but probably if you added up all the days I was away, it's about 2 months of the year. So it's by no means the mainstay of what I do overall. But you're right, it did develop from the success of my own business and the sharing of that success with others, and then repeated requests for me to go in and work with companies from, you know, Renault to Lloyds TSB to BT, right the way down to insurance companies, because of the obvious link that I'd had with my financial services work.
And what do they ask you to do? I mean, when they go and ask you to work with them, I mean, motivational speaking is quite a wide-ranging name, isn't it? Right, a title. Yeah. I mean, it can cover a multitude of things.
Yeah, the one thing I would not say I am is a motivational speaker, because I've seen people stand on a stage and try to motivate.
Yeah.
And I don't really like the word motivate, because often motivation comes from within. I think what most people need is they need the toolkit that will help them move from where they are right now. Most people are in a rut, they know where they want to go, they probably have a good skill set, but they just don't know how to make the transition into the place they want to be. They recognise it, they see it, they vision it, but they just don't know how to take the step. So I think I'm a practical applicator of ideas, and I take people, even my book that I've written was designed purely and simply to take people on a journey from inertia, which is where most people are, to an end result. And it's the practical steps they need to get there. By definition, the motivation comes from that process mm-hmm. taking effect and evolving. So the motivation sits on top of or underneath what I do in practical terms with people. I'm very much a doer rather than a talker, I guess.
But that presumably motivates you. I mean, the fact that you know that you can help other people get to that end goal.
Yeah, and I do, you know, I do motivate people. I do show people how to self-motivate. I do show people how to achieve results. Motivation is always easier if you know you're stepping and moving in the right direction. Yeah. So the motivational part is a very, very small part of what I do. Mostly what I focus on is changing people's mindset. You know, I'm no Darren Brown, I'm no Paul McKenna, but what I do is I educate people and I encourage people to sort of delve into their mind really and uncover all the things that are holding them back. I call it, you know, the discouragement club. We all live in the world of the discouragement club, and every business has one, epitomised by the group of people in the corner of the room who drink coffee, smoke cigarettes, read the newspaper and moan and groan about everything that's going wrong in their world.
Yeah.
So, you know, there is a vastness across all industries of people that work and live in that particular world, and it holds people back. So I try to get people away from that, change your mindset, and there's loads and loads of practical steps, hundreds in fact, that you can use to get people away from where they are right now. Then you have to combine that with the practical steps needed, so literally hold their hand through a process. And sometimes it might not necessarily be a 20-minute keynote or one-hour seminar or two-day workshop. It might be 3 months of coaching, whether it be by email or over the telephone, in order to get someone through that process.
Where did you get your inspiration from then? I mean, if you're helping people mm-hmm. And change their mindset to achieve what they want to achieve, did it just come naturally to you? Are there people for whom it is more simple than other people?
I think it was two things, really. One, my father died when I was very young. I was 7 years old when he contracted lung cancer, and he died, sadly, 2 years later. My mum was, my father was a very successful restaurateur, and he left my mum and 4 kids. I was the eldest, age 9, when he passed away. And so I was brought up very quickly. You know, I came from, half my family are Italian, and I was forced into the corporate world at a very young age. I was working in the family business when I was 13 to help really keep the roof over our heads, because my mum had never worked. And when I went into financial services, my mum had remarried, we'd had a fifth child had come along by then, and I saw my mum in the same place that she had been 10 years previously. And I promised myself when I went to financial services that I had a unique opportunity to ensure that if lightning ever struck twice, if anything happened to my stepfather, who we were very dependent on financially at the time, that I could do something about that. I had a unique opportunity to ensure that financially they would be taken care of. And it would be fair to say that for the first 2 years in the profession, I procrastinated. I did the classic, promise myself every single day that I would do this, I'd have the conversation, I'd, inverted commas, sell them a policy. And I went through that whole process of self-doubt and recrimination, and was I doing the right thing? And for 2 years I put that off. And eventually, and I can't explain to you why I eventually had the conversation, I guess I was just sick of making the promise every single day. I had the conversation with them. And eventually, after a laborious process, because my stepfather was found to have diabetes during the medical and so on, he then himself was contracted with terminal cancer, stomach cancer, 3 months after I set that policy up. And what that convinced me was that you don't have a tomorrow. If I'd have left that 3 more months, my mum would still be paying off the debts and living the horrors that she'd lived in 1978 when my dad died. Mm. And I realised that moment, and in some respects I look back on my life and I realise how lucky I am that I've been through that experience, because it convinced me that you cannot procrastinate, you cannot put off what you know you need to do. I'm no messiah, I don't have the answers to everyone's problems, but what I do know is if you do take positive steps forward in a direction, there will always be something that comes from it.
Yeah.
And very often, even if it's at the time seemingly quite a difficult situation that evolves, always, 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 in all the experience I've had over 22 years, there is always a positive outcome, always. The people who don't take the necessary steps, despite, and it's worse if you know you have to do it and don't, if you don't recognise you have to do it and fail to do that, it's, I guess, fairly different. But a lot of what I do is helping people to recognise what they have to do, and then it's literally taken through a process. So it's the practical application based on that inspiration. Because for me, there's a big difference between inspiration and motivation. Motivation is the practical steps. It's staying on track. Inspiration, which most people in my experience lack, is the end game. It's where they ultimately want to be in their life. And sometimes when I ask people, you know, what inspires you? Where is it you want to go in your life? 99% of the people I talk to have no idea.
Mm. And that's interesting, isn't it? Because my thought is that England is actually quite a negative in terms of business. England is quite a negative place.
Yeah.
Is that your experience based on the experience you've had of the 50-odd other countries in which you work?
Very much so. And I'm not going to sit here and start bad-mouthing the country in which we live. But it is endemic, I'm afraid. There is, and it's true of the US generally. There tends to be a scepticism that prevails in the corporate world over here and in the US. If you compare that to the entrepreneurial world of the Far East, China, the Philippines, Singapore, the average entrepreneurial age is something like 23, 24. So they are like sponges. They just take every bit of information you give them, and they will try. You know, they'll try anything you give them to do. Not necessarily based on the fact they believe you have more experience, but they are willing to give anything a go. They have no negativity towards anything, which I find remarkable, and it's a very nice environment in which to work. That said, there are a number of companies that I've worked with in the UK who buck the trend, and they are very positive, they're very motivated, they desire that their staff and their colleagues are treated right, achieve their optimum objective individually and collectively. So there are exceptions, and again, as I said, I'm not on a crusade to try and, you know, turn corporate Britain around, because it's nice sometimes to have a balance between positive and negative. And those that do want to adopt what you tell them and share with them, it's very fulfilling.
Where do you want to be maybe in another 10 years? Where's your end goal? If you're teaching people to see theirs, where's yours?
Well, I have two goals, really. The first one, corporately, is to get my both businesses to a place where they almost run themselves. At the moment, both businesses are very dependent on me. I can't say for a moment that I wish to clone myself in financial services. I have a great relationship with my clients. It's going to be impossible to replace me in that sense. But, we'll talk about this later, but I run the only business in the UK that charges fees based on purely on results. So if I'm successful for people, I charge them fees. And that actually prevails right the way through to my speaking work as well. I guarantee everything I do. I give every business that I work with a 30% production increase guarantee over a period of 3 months. Based on a number of parameters, i.e. they have to follow what I tell them to do.
Yes.
So I'm very confident in terms of outcomes. So I want to get both businesses to a point where they are less dependent on me individually, that we create a structure so that the business is run, because I have no desire to do anything other than what I do right now for the rest of my life until I keel over. And the other thing is to create that classic work-life balance, because I have a number of unfulfilled goals that I wish to achieve, and I'm very, very focused and targeted on achieving them. So over the next 10 years, I hope that those two things will happen.
You are very focused. I mean, I've asked you that one question of where you want to be, and you give me a really concise and definite answer of where that goal lies. Is that the secret to being successful actually in your working life, is actually knowing where you want to be and thinking about it and almost writing it down?
Mm. Yeah, it is. A lot of people say I'm very focused and I'm very driven. I wouldn't necessarily say I'm driven necessarily, because I'm not one of these people that will, you know, obliterate everyone that stands in my way. I'm very, very much a people person. I like to help others. I find it as fulfilling to see someone else achieve success if they send me an email and say, you know, you changed my life, or you did something that has totally transformed the way I do things. That to me is every bit as fulfilling as anything I achieve personally. So I guess in some respects, that is a natural thing that exists within me. Beyond that though, I think the drive and the focus is based very much on the fact that I do practice what I preach. Everything that I tell people to do, I do myself. It's nothing that you read in a textbook or you listen to other speakers and read books. I'm not one of those kinds of people. It's all based on personal experience, bringing in the experience sometimes of others, successes and failures, and sharing those in practical terms with the people I'm working with at the present time. So, I am very, very focused, but I don't think you can achieve very much unless you are. You've got to know where that end game is. And, you know, taking that one stage further, when you talk to businesses, one of the first questions I ask them is, what are the top three goals of your team? So let's say we're talking about a small team of four or five people. Most business owners have no idea what the personal goals of their team are. So how can you ever start a journey towards personal fulfillment and the fulfillment of others within your team? You know, a bit like the Japanese car manufacturing theory. You know, you dismantle the component parts, improve performance by 1%, bolt it all back together. It's a very, very basic idea, but very, very few people observe it.
Well, it's very good to see you. And thank you for spending time with us today.
Thanks.
Sandro Forte.